regardless of what goes on in other countries, Canada is and will always remain a country of the rule of law.
Ms. Meng was arrested pursuant to Canada's extradition treaty with the United States. There was no political involvement.
Well, the trading relationship will continue. You know, states, you cannot judge a trade relationship on a daily basis.
This situation demonstrates that Justin Trudeau's naive approach to relations with China isn't working.
As you've seen all week, Canada is caught in the middle between two superpowers. And while Ottawa says that it isn't political, China seems to feel differently. So is Canada being used by China and the U.S., and at what cost? That issue is here to answer those questions and more. And they're all with me in Toronto. Chantal Hébert, Andrew Coyne, and Althea Raj, all here at the table with me. Good to see you all. Okay, this has escalated quickly. It's been surprising, I think, some of the developments, or maybe not, given the pattern of behavior of China. Andrew, I'm going to start with you. Let's start with that question. Is Canada being used by either China and the United States?
We're being abused by China right now. They've basically kidnapped two of our citizens in retaliation for this. No, and I dispute that we're caught between two superpowers.
Okay.
America is a democracy. China is not. We are on the side of the democracies. This is not Donald Trump that made the request for extradition. It's U.S. law enforcement. This is an investigation that goes back some time, where they've had to present evidence in courts of law, where we have a long-running extradition treaty with them. It seems to me right and proper that we would respond as we did, both as a matter of law enforcement and as a matter of national security, given the abundant concerns about Huawei, not just in our own intelligence community, but in most of the Western mm-hmm. intelligence community. So it seems to me we had no choice but to do as we did. It has greatly enraged the Chinese, no kidding. So the issue to me now is, do we knuckle under to Chinese bullying or do we not? And I greatly hope we do not.
I'm not sure that we have the option of knuckling over the pressure from China, because we have so far been sticking to the rule of law, and we have a treaty and we have applied it. What happens when a Canadian judge gets to decide whether that court says yes to the extradition mm-hmm. request from the U.S. Mm-hmm. and reads the comments of President Trump that seems to suggest there's a political motive mm-hmm. behind this rather than a serious legal cause for requesting that is an open question.
Yeah.
It's not a given that that Canadian court will say yes to the U.S.
Right.
But before we get to that, and no politician in Ottawa is going to be calling a judge to say, please say no, or please say yes.
No.
But so before we get to that, we are going to have to bear with whatever China does. And there is very little that we can do except follow the process.
But how do you deal with, on the one hand, China, where rule of law is not something that they subscribe to, and on the other hand, the United States, where, as you say, okay, we should be on the same side, but where they are potentially undercutting what we're saying with the president's tweets? I mean, how do you... That's a very difficult road.
Well, and I think you saw not just the prime minister's office express frustration today at the president's comments yesterday, but also... senior officials in the government on the justice side say, no, this is a trade issue. It's not political. So if the Americans themselves and people from Mr. Trump's own team are trying to separate these issues, I think it just speaks to the president's kind of lone wolf stand on many issues that, you know, he kind of spewed out this thing and now they're trying to put the toothpaste back in the tube in many ways. What I found really shocking, actually, was the editorial from the Chinese ambassador in the Globe and Mail, in which he does not actually seem to recognize or realize that the rule of law that the government is talking about is not just a talking point. It is actually a fundamental pillar of our society. And perhaps that's the way things are done in China, but they're not the way things are done here. And I don't know if it's like a PR move or it's a real lack of understanding about political interference in this country.
I think it's a PR move. I think what they've calculated is we're the weakest link here. Their beef is really with the United States.
Yes.
They're the ones who want to arrest and presumably charge this woman.
And the beef is not necessarily about that. It's also about trade and tariffs, is it not?
Well, that's what China would like to portray this as being. The terms of the indictment of her have to do with breaking the sanctions on Iran.
Yeah.
And there's considerable evidence that Huawei has been involved in this. I'm not trying to convict anybody, but there was, it's non-trivial evidence to that regard. So that's really what this issue is about. That's what U.S. law enforcement will tell you this is about. Trump himself may have polluted the waters by saying things that are simply, he doesn't really have the power to do unless he's proposing to retrospectively pardon her or something. But there's legitimate law enforcement reasons to have made this extradition request. I agree entirely with Chantal that there may be reasons why our courts, one of the tests that has to be made is, would this be a crime in Canada as well as the United States? And because we're dealing with sanctions laws, that's not necessarily cut and dry. But the first step is absolutely to respond to the request.
But make no mistake, those presidential comments are now part of the record, and they will contaminate the U.S. case. And if that U.S. case for extradition does fail in a Canadian court, people will point back to those comments as part of the reasons why the judge decided that the U.S. wasn't operating in good faith. So, but there is no other remedy. This is not something you can resolve diplomatically. You're calling China and saying it's all going to be okay.
No, but you can resolve the part about our citizens being detained. And in the immediate...
You can? How?
Well,
Excuse me for asking the question.
No, but diplomatically, you could attempt it. You know what I mean? You could at least do something. You could pick up the phone and
we
make
are.
A phone call. Yes.
As far as I know.
But in that instance, how do you deal with a country that is using your citizens as pawns?
Well, one thing it seems to me is this ought to absolutely put on ice, at least for now, any talk of a free trade agreement. And China wants that free trade agreement at least as much as elements in our country do. So we've got to make clear that there's going to be costs for this kind of just lawless behavior. I mean, I absolutely agree, we are on the side of the rule of law here. The basically disappearance of two of our citizens in China has no legal process behind it whatsoever.
And make no mistake, other allies that China wants to have trade relationships with are taking note of what is happening.
Exactly.
No one takes lightly that citizens of a country in retaliation suddenly or arbitrarily disappeared.
But what's really interesting, I think, is to your point, is that they have picked on us as the weakest link. And, there is no outcry, or seemingly rather silent outcry, from our partners internationally about what has happened. They have not kidnapped Americans. They've kidnapped Canadians. And in many ways, I think this government is finding itself alone on the international stage. Like, it makes me think of their position on Saudi Arabia, for example. And once again, they think they're taking a principled position, and they look around and no one's lining up next to them.
Yes, but they're looking around at what? The French president that is dealing with two crises.
I'm not saying that they're not.
British PM barely made it through a confidence vote.
I mean,
and a U.S. administration that doesn't function normally.
But what they're also looking at, and China is looking at, is a government in Canada that in the first couple of years of its government was very clearly tilting towards China in ways that were troubling. Greenlighting the NORSAT sale, for example, when it hadn't really had the proper security vetting. It dragging its heels on Huawei, whether it should be given access to the 5G networks. Most of our fellow partners in the so-called Five Eyes intelligence network have said, no, they should not be part of this. We've been the last to really weigh in on this.
The UK still hasn't.
The UK is still looking at it. But I think this ought to really make clear that we've got to firm up our stand on this, that the sort of geopolitical strategy that liberals want to play of China's the next hegemon and we need to cozy up to them is way premature.
Right, but this is the eternal debate with China, is it not? How close do you get before things start going badly, as they are now?
When you get closer to China, and the government has tons of polls to show it, there was already unease in public opinion.
Yes,
and no government is going to get far out on this branch knowing that public opinion will increasingly be saying, wait a minute, we don't want this. You need, if not vocal support, at least benign indifference on the part of public opinion to be able to move this forward. And I think that's gone.
That will, and likely would never happen, I don't think, right? I mean, people
not anymore.
No.
Not for a while.
What is interesting is that they seem to not know exactly how to respond. On the one hand, you have like liberal MPs today saying like, I don't want to travel to China. We should not travel to China. The trade mission in BC was canceled. That was a provincial decision. But the travel advisory has not changed. And the department is usually rather risk adverse about sending political signals that are too bold. And yet you look and they're like, well, there's two of our citizens that are gone. Clearly, you should be taking more action than you are taking. And it's very interesting that they don't actually seem to know what direction they want to swim in.
Yeah, or is it publicly? We're not seeing that. Because, I mean, I think the thing that struck me this week was, if I thought Chrystia Freeland was diplomatic and careful with her language before when it came to Donald Trump, I have never seen her more deliberate in her speaking than I did this week around this.
Yeah, and then she had to put some distance between our process and Trump's statement. Yeah. I mean, she had to make clear this is, as Chantel said, this is harming the U.S. Mm-hmm. case, mm-hmm. and it's certainly harming our case to be
harming our citizens.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Thanks, everybody. Appreciate it.